It's good. So once again, I really happy to participate in this conference, which one of the best which has attended. Very good speakers, expert in field, so we have very good overview of the problem. And by the way, it's, when I prepared, I found that in 2004, maybe, I don't remember, but I participated in some conference in Germany. And among the list of email, I found Lilia Berry. So maybe you remember that it was conference about some development of high temperature superconductivity, and there were some reports from room temperature superconductivity. For me, it was really something weird that people talk about room temperature superconductivity seriously, even theoretical. But anyway, things are going, and now we are very close to room temperature superconductivity. It's really strange. So let me start with my talk. I want to combine two things: metallic hydrogen and high temperature superconductivity. For me, it's natural and natural how hydrides appeared. So let's start from with metallic hydrogen. So metallic hydrogen, of course, when you look in the morning in the sky, you can see, of course, Venus, but also these days you can see Jupiter. And in this case, you maybe will remember that Jupiter is full of metallic hydrogen. 70% of Jupiter is metallic hydrogen. And therefore, it has huge magnetic.
Mikhail,
yes.
Sorry.
Yes.
Can you use a microphone or without, I don't know if you have eardrops or something.
Oh, yes. Sorry.
Because that we heard some echo, something that is disturbing.
Now it's good?
Yes, probably better.
Better or good?
Yeah. Thank you.
Now it's good, yes?
Yeah.
Much better.
Okay, good. So when you see, so Jupiter, amazingly, so, and now Juno Misse study Jupiter, in particular metallic hydrogen inside of Jupiter. Amazingly, in the lab, we can also study Jupiter. We can plunge in Jupiter pretty deeply because we can go to pressure above 2 megabars. So we can go to metallic hydrogen. And so metallic hydrogen itself, first of all, hydrogen. Of course, hydrogen itself, it's basic of modern science. It's quantum mechanics and so on, needless to tell. And dense hydrogen, also very interesting, because it was predicted that dense molecular hydrogen will go to atomic state at very high pressures. And this atomic state for us is very interesting because it's expected high temperature superconductivity. And also other interesting phenomena could be in metallic hydrogen. So question is that hydrogen is, in fact, is not simple substance that could be imagined. For instance, it has a lot of phases. And you see some phases which predicted Picard and Nitz already a long time ago, and they write predictions. And we concentrate on the low temperature field of hydrogen. So where predictions were done at zero kelvins. And so you see, ultimately, through some structures, hydrogen will go to atomic state. Yesterday we knew that it could be at very high pressures, unfortunately for experimentalists. So atomic hydrogen still big challenge, but molecular hydrogen is studied pretty well. Even we don't have X-ray basically, but we can study with Raman in infrared spectroscopy, and with help of theory, we know a lot about hydrogen. Here we're interested about metallization of hydrogen. And it's possible in theory, many theoretical work predicts that it's possible that hydrogen will metallize through closing of band gap. So in some points of key points, bands will overlap and hydrogen will go to semi-metals. So metals with low concentration of carriers. And yesterday, Pierre Leone also showed us how this transition can happen theoretically. So main point here is that indirect overlap will happen obviously at lower pressures than direct overlap. And this may, you will see, make difference. And how would experimentally study it? So we did, so mostly, so easy, I would say, what is available method on optical method, Raman, absorption, reflection. Most difficult method is electrical conductivity measurements. And so we spent most efforts for electrical conductivity measurements. Here are some examples. So sample at 380 GPa. And sample contact with four electrodes, and we can measure conductivity. What I want to say here is that we found 2016 that when we cool down sample, so resistance increased, but strongly dropped at 200 kelvins, and then nearly temperature independent, but some arrays increased at lower temperature. What is important here, as usually in hydrogen, is very difficult to reproduce. So people once obtain result, publish it, and it's very difficult to reproduce objectively even, because it's always ultimate pressure, ultimate conditions. So here we reproduce it sometime later, and basically the same temperature behavior. And here you see our recent results, which shows that the same as the first experiment. So first we increase resistance increase and drops and nearly temperature independent. And so importantly here is that we have done it from 4 megabars, 400 GPa to 300 GPa. And even here we observe transition, even observe semiconducting behavior. So we observe all from metal to semiconductor and insulator. And repeatedly, so we have many results in different configurations. I don't tell here about precautions because we have different gaskets to exclude some artifacts. And also another tool what we have in hand is Raman spectroscopy. And Raman spectroscopy, sometimes we go to very high pressures, like here nearly again 280 GPa. And what we found that at some pressure, above some pressure, intensity of Raman, you see, decreases. And Vibron also decreases. And amazingly, this decrease in intensity and this blue point decrease of resistance coincide. So it most likely at pressures above 300 GPa, there is some transition. So what is this transition? This is, as I showed before, in fact, theoretical calculations were independently done and it was done a little bit earlier. But you remember this slide? Yeah, so it consists with theoretical calculations here, which shows that first indirect gap closes. And when indirect gap closes, conductivity appears and hydrogen transformed to metal, semi-metal, which become more better and better metal at with pressure. What recently was found, yesterday we listened about this transition which found Lubert infrared absorption at higher pressure, more than 400 GPa. And what kind of transition here is not clear yet. So either it's structural transition or maybe electronic transition. There are also predictions. It could be metal, but method infrared absorption, it has some intrinsic limitation because absorption below 800 centimeters cannot be measured. And therefore, at least hypothetically, possibility of small gap remains. What interesting here is that we plot our Raman data and infrared data, because in Raman data, we saw the disappearance of Raman data happened around 400 GPa. Recently, I will stop here, we calibrated pressure, and therefore we can compare directly infrared measurements and Raman measurements. And it's likely we have the same transition from Raman and from infrared and Raman. So now what we have with phase diagram, so from electrical measurements and Raman measurements and electrical measurements, a transition from phase 5 to phase 3, here cycles to metallic state. The metallic state started now even 300 GPa with new pressure scale. And maybe likely there is another transition to metallic state already at 400 GPa. And ultimately at very high pressures, unacceptable so far, still it's atomic transition. So this is state with metallic hydrogen. In our study, high pressure, of course, high pressure plays a crucial role. So once again, in the ESCO, it's 3.5 megabar. We reach this pressure even, but we cannot reach in Jupiter because it's 7 terapascal, but still very big and very good progress in high pressures. So here, just for comparison, you see high pressure also, it's pulse, dynamic pressure. And here, huge facility, and you can see here, huge, very expensive facility, which give pressure around 1 terapascal. Of course, sometimes more. But comparable pressure can be achieved with very small, very, very cheap, it's ironically a cheap device, it's diamond anvil cell, which now walk up to 1 terapascal. But also it has many advantages, like because a variety of techniques are possible, X-ray optics and so on and so on. But also it's very difficult to reach very high pressures because diamond anvil cell can plastically deform, hydrogen can crack diamond anvil, and also defects in diamond anvil really play significant and bad role. So it's premature failure of diamond. As I mentioned, it was difficult to compare results of different groups because different groups use different pressure scales at pressure above 3 megabars. Recently, what we have done, we calibrated it. So we put in diamond anvil cell gold, measure equation of state of gold, and therefore we know pressure from dynamic experiment, and calibrated against of this step, small step in Raman spectra, which can conserve the ice pressure gauge. And so you see big difference in at 5 megabar, around 100 GPa between old scale and present scale. But now, since established. So just to advertise and demonstrate what does it mean pressure, because pressure sometimes really make amazing things, like sodium becomes transparent, or nitrogen become polymeric and go to atomic state, and boron also superconductivity. So I mean that we are well prepared for current measurements of superconductivity at 2 megabars pressure and above. And now I want to turn to superconductivity. Now, first of all, superconductivity and hydrogen are very important problems together, as according to Ginzburg and according to his list. I also show this because Ginzburg was always interested in high temperature superconductivity. And he published even book, High Temperature Superconductivity, but no relations for cuprates, because you see this year. Because that time they seriously discuss possibility of high temperature superconductivity within BCS theory. And within BCS theory, I will skip everything. So just this approximation. So basically, optimistically, critical temperature could be very high, formally infinite if we have a large electron form interaction and system with high characteristic phonons. And, but on the other hand, the BCS theory does not help too much to experimentalists. They indicate that, of course, it should be light elements, but basically nothing more. And this point was really for disappointment for Matthias. He was a great experimentalist. He discovered more than 1,000 new superconductors, just empirical. And he did it pure experimental work. And and he's disappointed because after BCS theory, no kink on this plot of critical temperature versus time. So this is not predictive theory. And he told that that room temperature will be always remain like a pipe dream. So this is state to this, but of course life going and this new superconductor appeared. Cuprate, of course, I cannot mention this. I mean, discuss this and iron superconductor. And we will talk about this green BCS superconductor, hydrides, of course. And so hydrides, again, Ashcroft played significant role in this because he predicted, he in fact suggested that superconductivity in hydrogen dominant material could be as high as in pure hydrogen for similar reason, physical reason, like as pure hydrogen, high frequencies and no screening and so on and so on. It's interesting, he did not really give predictions or estimates, just qualitatively. And he proposes materials which alone, in fact, later was not even conformed as high temperature superconductors mostly. But idea was really great. But we try to follow this idea experimentally, empirically, I would say blindly. And we had some very, very limited success because we found some metallic state in this compound, but we did not really find superconductivity. And here's some example. So theory should help. But from theoretical point of view, as Chris yesterday in his Wavy talk, mentioned about this event. So predictions also superconductivity in the lane from intuition, from chemical intuition. And also we try to follow general suggestion Ashcroft and this article also, because I was amazed how critical temperature could be really announced, 260 Kelvin. What happened later, I will skip a little bit, but later what happens that Roald Hoffman was really disappointed that his intellectual power failed against computer. But it always happened like this in chess and so on. And but he wrote some very interesting, in fact, essay in this article about this thoughts about. So computer won as usual and recently. And for us also was, for me also was shocking experience when we did experiment on the lane and found this phase. In fact, this phase is not conductive, but later we found, found independently that it was prediction of Chris Pickard in Nitz. It was really amazing for me. And also we found superconductivity here, but not very high. So its prediction of the Ashcroft expectation also failed. And now we know that from yesterday's talk that the lane could be revisited, and maybe it will show something very interesting once again. But what happened, you know this, and most people here are from crystal predictions, from this is really a great development. And very fortunate for us, I mean, for high pressure communities, that crystal predictions start to work in high pressure field. And it turns out this combination is very fruitful because high pressure field allows a lot of phases, a lot of combinations. It's much better than to work with some materials at ambient pressure. So we have great progress. And in this progress with prediction long time ago, I mean, one of the first prediction of very high critical temperature. And we tried, by the way, immediately, but for some reason we didn't succeed. So other people succeeded only recently. And we try different things, but finally we stopped at H2S. And unfortunately, I skipped this file because aluminum hydride was another good example for comparison with predictions. Again, was another point of for me for amazing that predictions, again, bigger than this, were very correct. And so just so what we have? We have general theory, BCS theory. We have good suggestion from Ashcroft. We have crystal now structure predictions and calculations and experiment. And experiment, as I show, we're ready for experiment. Even now, pressure are needed, required not so high as pure hydrogen, but still it's about 200 GPa. And we have everything for these measurements. So we have electrical measurements. Here, for instance, we have sample lanthanum in this case surrounded by hydrogen and for electrical needs, and we can measure superconductivity. So let me start. So we occasionally found started with hydrogen sulfide because for different reasons. One of reason was because H2S was available, we can buy it. Second reason that predictions was from Yang-Min Ma group, which was, we had successful collaboration with sodium, remember. They predicted, he predicted transparent sodium, so it's also good for experimentalists to know this. Theoretician can predict it well. I think the opposite also right. So theoretician also think for experimentalists who do reliable experiments. So it's very clear. So we started with H2S. It was not good to work with this substance because it's toxic and smelly and difficult to work, but we succeeded. Later on, we do much more elegant nowadays. It can be done just from sulfur, reaction sulfur with deuterium or hydrogen with laser heating, and the same result. H2S. And so we worked with Alex Drozdov on hydrogen sulfide and found some superconductivity. It's around here, no scale, but it's around 100 Kelvin. So we found below 100 Kelvin, but TC increases with, and it was superconductivity because zero, it was good zero. And if you see here plot against pressure, so basically we confirmed predictions, star predictions. It already was great result because critical temperature was very high. And so we can try to hide this result on our screens, but still it's impossible to hide completely. And we spent more than half of year for these measurements because we want to be sure that everything reproducible and reliable, because it's very clear that it was a great result. But even more, we found that critical temperature increased with pressure very much to really unbelievable and predictable values. And we understood many things. Important point was understood that annealing very important. So after annealing, everything stabilized around 200 kelvins, and we can work repeatedly. One very important point here was that we observed isotope effect. When we replace hydrogen for deuterium, critical temperature decreases substantially. And it shows immediately that we have phonon type superconductor. So it's, and of course, the isotope effect is really huge in comparison with normal superconductors. And another thing that we guessed that H2S, because we cannot explain everything with H2S. So we guess because sulfur is hypervalent, has hypervalency, so it can attract more hydrogen than two. And so in this case, disproportion plus sulfur. And it happens that our guess was right. And of course, we spend a lot of time for different measurements, for instance, for X-ray, for optical measurements, for infrared measurements. They were successful also. And X-ray measurements also confirm that we have, in case of H2S, we have H3S structure and sulfur. And why we know the H3S? Because at the same time, with our finding, this remarkable work appeared. So in this work, another system was considered H2S plus hydrogen, this model of this experimental work. And they found finally that at high pressure, very high pressure, that there's very simple, beautiful cubic structure appears. And if calculate superconductivity of this structure, so critical temperature was exactly as we observe. Of course, it's coincident because this calculation were not precise, but fortunately for these calculations, errors just cancel each other. So anyway, it was clear for theoreticians that most likely superconductivity is explained by this structure. And therefore a lot of theoretical works appeared and the system was understood very, very quickly. So once again, let me express that, because sometimes people claim that we just confirm this theoretical work. In fact, we did not know about this. And this was a really serendipitous discovery. There's no question about this. And also very good that it was done independently and simultaneously. So the things accelerated dramatically because, of course, theoretical support, it's very important and influence. But still about experiment. So experiment, in fact, complicated. And some example here, you see yttrium hydride system. Just curious that when we start with yttrium and add hydrogen, you see volume expand maybe around three times. So it's even visually, you see how sample expanded when hydrogen goes inside. And for all these phases, we should do X-ray, we should do superconductivity. We did also isotope effect, so a lot of work. And for this particular system, we found the critical temperature more than 240 GPa. That's also very important that we don't have only one H3S, but we found, and other people found other superconductors. So field developed, because sometimes magnesium borate, in spite of many efforts, no progress with critical temperature was. So this is important development. Another thing that would also be important that also reproducibility, because in this particular case, for instance, we have good agreement with another group. And here, of course, except some exceptional example, beautiful superconductivity in lanthanum hydride, and 200, even higher critical temp, 250 kelvins. And we have here, as I told, we studied many phases. We found also isotope effect. In this case, it was difficult because also isotope not only influence on not only superconductor temperature but structure. It was difficult to stabilize this particular structure to calculate isotope effect, but we succeeded. And also what is very clear from here is that basically what we see here, metallic hydrogen doped with lanthanum, because a lot of hydrogen here, so, and we have only 10% of doping of metallic hydrogen. And when we have this gain, it's 250, so only minus 20 Celsius, it's very easy to cool this sample. And just in fact, I dream always, but still we didn't realize it, just to demonstrate visually. So we could do spend, in fact, 5 minutes, and we can cool down this cell, yeah, surrounded with dry ice. It's really quick because only minus 20. And we have portable device or meter, and so we can even transfer this everywhere to any conference to show this superconductivity. And yeah, and so it should be also even further progress. I mean, because it was announced nearly room temperature superconductivity. The problem is, but there are problems with this. And one, the main problem, reproducibility, because still 2 years later, that was not reproduced. For instance, let me show you here. We try to reproduce, in fact, spend a lot of efforts and time and resources, but what we have here stars, and basically we found the critical superconductivity similar to H3S or less. So no agreement with announced room temperature superconductivity. And also a lot of theoretical works try to find solution for room temperature superconductivity, but they could not find. And also yesterday talk Eva Zurek, she also did not find superconductivity. Let me stop on this also. In fact, I will talk more in more detail in reply to the previous talk, but here just mention about this very sharp transition, unusually sharp transition. Of course, it could be, it's not excluded, but still too sharp, it will notice, but theoreticians. And and also Hirsch and Marsiglio, they also claim that in our superconductors, not only in this way, but all hydrogen superconductors also have no broadening. But in fact, we have, because you see here magnesium boride with broadening, and here H3S with broadening. And somehow, and you see here broadening with magnetic field. And somehow Hirsch and Marsiglio, they missed it. It's some kind of manipulation of data. And even more, what is really irritating is that I will talk in more detail, spent time for writing this big article for educational purposes. And directly mentions this, that we have brought, so it published. And also I told many times on conference, we have brought in our sulfide. But in today talks again, we don't have brought in. How is possible? So it's really amazing. So anyway, so let's continue in positive way. So it's, on the other hand, all these questions, criticism, of course, in somehow useful. Of course, it takes too much time to answer all this criticism, all these particular questions, but somehow there is also useful results, because it becomes completely evident what we have done. And magnetic properties are very important. So, of course, it was clear from the beginning, because our nature and so was in the beginning was rejected, because we did not have magnetic measurement, because it must be Meissner effect, must be susceptibility measurements. And we have done it very quickly with this. We built this small cell, especially for this experiment, because the estimate shows that we, in principle, we can measure in a small cell, but at 2 megabars, this effect. And we have measured it. And here is our first measurements, which are fortunately absolutely right. And in fact, we even in this first publication, we have measurements also for deuterium. So we have enough evidences that our measurements were right. Another thing that after that, nobody repeated, and even we did not do it because it was not necessary. I mean, necessary in the sense that superconductivity was accepted after that just by measuring zero resistance and dependence on magnetic field. Because magnetic susceptibility measurements are really difficult. But fortunately, recently we developed significantly these measurements. And here you see these measurements of susceptibility, and from this we measured first critical field for H3S and what is new also for lanthanum hydride. And from this we have penetration depths of these superconductors. Also, we have done a lot of magnetic measurements in collaborations with Tallahassee and Los Alamos in strong magnetic field and pulse study in pulse magnetic field to the maximum. Still, this magnetic field are not enough to suppress superconductivity because critical field is really high. But this field are high to at least to reliably estimate critical field, second critical field, high critical field. So from this we have coherent waves. And finally, in fact, it was suggested by Jörg Hirsch like ultimate test for superconductivity. Okay, and we have done it. But it was really, in fact, it was useful because you see it's very clear demonstrations that we have superconductivity. What you see here, let me explain here. So we put our sample in high magnetic field and switch off magnetic field. When we applied magnetic field, so flux went to inside of the sample in form of vortices. And when we switch it, vortices stay there because in many cases, it's superconductive two type superconductors, there is pinion. And in our case, it's strong pinion. So vortices remains. And when we switch off and see with time, so during couple days, we see nearly no, only slight decrease of signal. So it means, of course, it's difficult, impossible to explain something not your superconductivity. And also it was very useful exercise, in fact, because this method of trapped flux, in fact, it turned out very useful. Not only demonstrative, but useful. Because for instance, when we increase temperature, so signal disappeared when critical temperature reached, in this case, 190 Kelvin for hydrogen sulfide. Also, we found this kink. And this kink comes from salvo. So it means that we also can distinguish different phases in our sample. And here also we can find also first critical field because we see at some point at these values of you see signal appears not below, so we exactly find magnetic field when vortices start to go inside the sample, and here again. And here, again, magnetic field. In fact, we will stop in more details later. And Vasily Minkov, he was first author of this, his measurements, he will explain in more details this experiment. And finally, why this experiment is useful, because it's zero external magnetic field. So it means that high pressure measurements where the ground is huge because cell, even small cell is huge in comparison with sample. And so in this case, we don't have the ground and therefore we have big gain with signal. So it means that we can measure even much smaller sample at high pressures. So So it was a very useful exercise. And so finally, we have basic parameters of superconductors. So coherence length, lambda penetration length. And finally, we can conclude what we have is type two, of course, superconductors, but moderate, not strong, as could be expected, like for cuprates. Because we have not large penetration depths for the superconductors. And just let me finalize a little bit. So experimentally found two families, but this family is just alone. And big family of cage-like superconductors present lanthanum. And you already will know very well this, that here hydrogen covalently bonded each other, and lanthanum supply charge to hydrogen network. So it's very good, in fact, model for metallic hydrogen.
just 1 second, you have about 5 more minutes.
No, in fact, I already finished. Really, I skipped a lot, so I really finished. So I go not in my field, but in fact, of course, I try to follow theoretical work predictions, because for us it's also very important to understand where to go experimentally. What is promising, what is not. Long time ago, I noticed these predictions, and I hope theoreticians will comment it, because it's really very good predictions, and it's also another family of potential superconductors. It's based on molecular units, in here methane was doped with magnesium. Here this material can be somehow considered like a xylane unit with doped with barium. And here, borane, again, doped. And here, of course, very interesting work, very recent work. Hopefully it will work because it's ambient pressure prediction. But idea also is very similar. So this unit, but doped, correct, I mean, smartly doped. So it's very interesting development potentially for experimentalists. So it could be even ambient pressure superconductivity in these materials. And somehow we don't discuss here another thing that, it's discussed not much, I would say, without hydrogen. So of course we discussed a little bit boron carbon systems, which also promising at ambient pressure. And here covalent bonding similar to H3S. But somehow it was forgotten, or maybe it's very difficult to do experimentally. It's diamond-based or carbon-based system, because long time ago, Cohen worked on these systems, and he expected pretty high critical temperature for diamond if dope. Of course, problem with doping, because it should be very strong doping with diamond, and it's difficult to do with pure diamond. But it was done, seems to be done with Q carbon, where doping around 30% of boron, and critical temperature was pretty high. In fact, it's a game some long time ago, and it was not a game conformed to other laboratories. Big disadvantages. In fact, we thought about this, but somehow did not realize, because experiment a little bit difficult and we don't have time arrangement and so on. But this is, I would say, very promising. So also direction. Of course, we don't discuss here two-dimensional systems. So it's a lot of things could be experimentally tried, but all try always a lot of efforts. So we should carefully select what's the most probable material is. And I don't mention, by the way, here fails. Of course, we have fails. We have examples where did not find superconductivity in predicted system, and where system predicted. What can we tell in this? We cannot publish. And maybe we are in wrong pressure. So maybe pressure was predicted not correctly. Maybe synthesis was not right, and so on. So this, so it's very basically typical situation. We cannot find some prediction penta structures, but it doesn't mean that they don't exist. So I want to tell that sometimes it's not very easy to claim something that just absent, or superconductivity does not exist. It's really for me difficult to not to say that in contrast to Hirsch's claim. So something and no superconductivity hydrat. Something wrong, no superconductivity. We cannot work like this. Since the anomaly is more complicated and should be carefully everything considered. And so let me finish, just really finish. So our efforts were on metallic hydrogen, and we, in fact, it's something wrong, it's shifted. So it's 300 GPA. We found that hydrogen transformed to semi-metallic state. And also with hydrides, it's some kind of match all these two approaches, because in lanthanum hydride, also superconductivity, we know theoretically, it's from hydrogen. So it means that for pure hydrogen, superconductivity could be close to this value, 250 kelvins or something like this. Yeah, many thanks for your attention, and of course, many thanks for our group, which work very hard, efficiently, intensively, and I would say, I hope we enjoy our work. And of course, we have a lot of really very good collaboration with sometimes ago with the University of Mainz, and also very intensive collaboration with MagLab and in Tallahassee and Los Alamos. And we have done a lot of experiments in APS and also other synchrotrons, and with Osaka University, some collaboration with Polish scientists, and collaboration, very nice collaborations with Tom Timusk and people from Synchrotron Soleil. And I'm grateful a lot for the very interesting discussion with theoreticians, which really inspiring and elucidate things a lot. And of course, Max Planck Society, because we have very good support from Max Planck Society. Really, we're happy to be here. And in fact, we don't have problem from support. So many thanks again for your attention.